thanks a lot, Antra, for taking out time and joining us today for the webinar session. I am really excited to host you today. So before we start today's session, I would like to give you all a little brief about Pragmatic Leaders. At Pragmatic Leaders, you all are part of a global family of aspirational professionals who proactively help each other and are invested in each other's career growth. Pragmatic Leader functions like a full-stack global career accelerator that rests on three core pillars. Pillar one is educate. We help you upskill via our proven courses and professional industry coaches. Pillar two is engage. We run a global community of product managers on Slack with access to online and offline meetups across the globe. Pillar three is employ. We operate a job platform and dedicated interview preparation courses to help you crack your dream job. So with that note, let's begin the session. Antra has already joined us. Once again, welcome and thank you, Antra, for joining us today. I'm sure everyone is also super excited for this session.
Thank you so much, Piyush, and I can't thank you enough for giving us this opportunity. Also, I'd like to extend a warm thanks to everyone today. I know 9 p.m. is a prime slot for multiple live videos and webinars that everyone has options to watch these days. So thank you for taking the time to join us. I wanted to structure this conversation in a very broad format. What I was hoping to do is within the first few minutes of time that I can share some of my learnings, talk about what is civic technology, what is the civic technology ecosystem, where does it stand in India today, and how can product managers, developers and others actually contribute to the ecosystem. I'm going to just dive straight in with the presentation. I'll start by sharing an introduction to myself. My name is Antara. I'm the founder of an organization called Civis. At Civis, I will go into a little bit of depth into what we do, but essentially my foray in the civic technology ecosystem has been an ongoing process since 2015. I think in 2015, I was somewhere bit by the bug to understand how technology can help governance in India. And that led me to volunteer with an Argentinian civic technology movement, also understand how technology is used in the election process, how is technology used within government functioning, and dabble in multiple fields to understand where it is that we can actually come in and have a very sort of meaningful impact. I have a background in political science, so that perhaps lent itself very naturally to the space that I find myself in. But I think going beyond that, there are what excites me about civic technology and about Civis today is that there are a set of very large scalable challenges that we're designing for. These challenges include how do you reach people who don't have internet access, how do you enable their participation in government processes, etc. I'll go into that in greater depth as we go along, but I think what drives me to be involved in this field and to be interested in it is really I wouldn't want to use the word disruptor. I feel like it might be a little overused, but essentially creating systems that have never existed before within very complex organizations and stakeholders. So with that, I'm going to dive straight in. Civis is a nonprofit organization, and at Civis, what we believe is each one of us knows what is best for our communities and our peers, right? So we empower individuals to co-create the laws that impact them with the government before these laws are finalized. To give you an example of what this means, in India, the government actually asks for citizens' feedback on every law that it puts out. And this is not after the law has been passed, but before the law has been passed, right? So what Civis does is we enable people to find out about these new laws on which the government is seeking feedback. We simplify it so that individuals who do not have legal or policy backgrounds can understand it. And we ultimately close the feedback loop by sharing all the feedback that we gather directly with government authorities. To give you an example, there are two very interesting policies open right now, which is one of which is the draft strategy for national open digital ecosystems. And the second is the transgender persons' protection of rights rules. On these two policies, people like you and me can go in and share our feedback. Say, for example, on the node strategy, we could say that I've managed open source communities. I understand how open source development works. These are the policy areas that you have outlined for open source, but perhaps it might be more beneficial if you did X, Y, or Z, right? This feedback, considering that you would be a subject matter expert coming in to comment on this, would actually be taken into account by the government and might actually shape the way the law gets framed and implemented going forward. I'm going to stop with that about Civis. We do a lot of interesting work with government partners as well, and I'm happy to speak about that in detail in the Q&A session if somebody has a specific interest to that. But I'm going to now take this opportunity to get to the real meat of why some of you have joined us today, which is understanding civic technology. A typical session on a new concept might start with a definition. I'm not going to start with a definition because I think the definition of civic tech is disputed, not disputed, but perhaps something one that we still keep going back and forth on to try and define. What I am going to do is perhaps take us back in time, a fair amount of time, and explain what really would have been the socio-economic and societal factors that have led to civic tech coming into play today. So I promised to go back in time, and I'm taking you back to 1436 when the Gutenberg's printing press was first designed, right? So when we look at the printing press, and this might seem a little bit incongruous, but please bear with me, I promise it'll make sense. When we look at the printing press, we think about what that did for society. It actually enabled greater share of information. So at the time before the printing press came about, one had to actually physically hand write any copy of a book that we wanted to put out. But this printing press made it such that you could mechanically enter or copy books. And because of this led to a revolution in news media, in actual print media, in book publishing, different sorts of industries got disrupted by the printing press, because now you could share information freely in a quicker and more cost-effective way. Where this really played out for governance was that now there was more information available to the citizen on what exactly the government was doing, right? This wasn't, of course, an immediate thing, but I'm just trying to trace a highlight over time. So I think the printing press was perhaps the first disruptor, but the second disruptor, which is where we stand today, is the internet, right? So now we've typically seen the internet being a disruptor in multiple ways. But what I want to highlight is that it has also disrupted the way citizen and government engagements work, right? Jeremy Hymans and Henry Timms, in their book New Power, which is a strong recommendation to read, actually explain what this looks like. So say, for example, I as a citizen today can tweet at a movie star, and they would probably respond to me with some amount of funny anecdote, or I can tweet to people that I don't know and get a response, right? Similarly, with a few clicks of the button, I can order an Uber, I can get responses from systems that traditionally were non-responsive at the touch of a button, right? When you contrast that to governance, you start to see that there are certain dichotomies. We are used to sharing feedback or voting once every 5 years. We're not used to, perhaps, or don't have the ability to yet continuously engage with governments, continuously share feedback. If there's a pothole in front of the house, you should be able to report it to the government and for the government to be able to fix it in a seamless and technologically enabled way. So that is I think where civic technology actually saw rise. If in this book on New Power, what the authors propound is that old power was basically consolidated in one unit or on the like a top-down sort of approach, whereas new power is one which is a bottom-up approach and actually values or creates value by virtue of the fact that many people hold power. So if we were to look at it from a governance standpoint, perhaps old power would be a centralized government working for its citizens. New power could look like something like networked governance, right? Where every city or every individual has the ability to actually access or to be able to fix certain problems or has the ability to have a say in something greater than what they have had so far. I think new power is very key in understanding the evolution of civic technology, and primarily that is because technology has now given us the tools to be able to communicate back to governments, to different corporates, and if that communication was still one way, we would have perhaps not needed civic technology. But now when you are able to communicate back to the government and the government systems perhaps are not built or equipped to deal with that sort of influx of large mass of communication, that is where an opportunity arises to solve for some of these challenges. So what is civic technology exactly? Civic technology is technology that is used to empower citizens or help make government more accessible, efficient, and effective. Again, I think if you look this up, there would be multiple definitions of what exactly is civic technology. Some people call it gov tech, some people call it civic tech. This definition more or less encapsulates what I see as civic technology, and it was put out by Omidyar Network, which is a philanthropic investment firm. So, when we look at civic technology as a whole, where is it, what has the evolution been? So civic technology came onto the scene, and where have we taken it? Where are the areas where civic technology is more profounded than less? I'm going to dig into that now. So this excellent visualization is courtesy the Civic Tech Field Guide. And what we see here is that essentially America, United States of America, and France are perhaps the two areas where there has been a lot of activity in civic technology. This circle sort of encapsulates Southeast Asia and India within the same gamut. But even in India, there has been a lot of civic technology activity that has been taking place. When we look at the history of civic technology, I think these countries are actually the ones who are pioneering civic technology, so to speak. And within this, the kind of interventions that you see in these countries, some of the incredible ones are helping voter registrations, creating voter registrations through a seamless online process, recording messages for your elected representatives. So calling a particular number, leaving them a 1 minute voice note on what exactly are your concerns and how can they help you address them. You have other very interesting systems on participatory budgeting. So actually going out to an entire city in France, and this has happened very successfully, to say that, What do you want in your municipal budget? Do you want more parks? Do you want more lighting? Do you want different roads, different infrastructure? And channeling that back to the government in a way that the government can actually take cognizance of citizens' concerns and make these services available. In addition to that, I think there are many very interesting use cases to civic tech, and courtesy the Knight Foundation, we have this excellent sort of visualization on what are the topics, clusters, and thematic areas on which civic technology functions. As you see here, a big cluster is actually peer-to-peer local sharing. This could be sharing of resources, different modes of information. You have also neighborhood forums. In India, we have local circles, which is one neighborhood forum, where essentially you have people within a street or within a limited geography coming in and sharing updates, sharing resources, chatting with each other. So that comes under neighborhood forums. You also have a lot of work being done on data access and transparency. And this could be in terms of municipal budgets. How accessible are municipal budgets? Can people actually understand what is happening with the municipal finances in their city? You have information crowdsourcing. So this would come into perhaps in India, we have an excellent platform called I Change My City, which actually allows you to crowdsource information on potholes or on specific civic issues that then go into an aggregated dashboard for the municipality. In addition to that, and of course, this Knight Foundation map is US focused, but I'm trying to draw parallels between this and what you see in India today. Public decision making, which is the forum in which CIVIS would fall, is a new and niche and unexplored area of really trying to understand how can you enable two-way dialogue between citizens and governments at scale. And visualization and mapping is again a very interesting space, because governments perhaps do not have the adequate technology to map cities and require sort of private intervention in this space. I'm now going to come down to what civic technology looks like in India. There was an Umidyar network, Village Capital, and CIIE report published earlier last year, which spoke about the status of civic technology in India. And I think that is something I would very highly recommend for people to read. In India at the moment, there are about 450 to 475 civic technology startups. Different scale stages, different levels of maturity, but this is a sizable number, and I'd like to draw your attention to that. Civic technology, though it's a growing field, it's actually expanding very quickly in India, and a lot of that is to do with the government's willingness to partner with organizations, also with the willingness perhaps and the adoption of technology at a rapid scale, internet technology at a rapid scale. Those have all been contributing factors to actually lead to a spurt of civic technology organizations in India. There are primarily two subsectors in India. So whereas the Knight Foundation map perhaps visualizes about 10 sectors, in India there are primarily two. One is on service delivery and government service delivery, and the second one is on citizens' engagement. Government service delivery may perhaps come into the category of the passport, e-passport kendras, for example, where the government needs to extend a service to a citizen, and they need some amount of support to be able to extend that in an efficient manner. When it comes to citizens' engagement, it could be any of the neighborhood apps that we spoke about. It could be apps like CIVIS. It could perhaps even extend to change.org or currently with the COVID relief platforms that are popping up, like REAP Benefits Neighborhood Dashboard or multiple other dashboards to aggregate citizens, enable them to communicate with one another and also with governments and other stakeholders. Interestingly, also, this report did a survey to understand how civic technology is perceived in India, and about 50% of the respondents believe that civic technology will help citizen trust in government and its services. I'll move forward now to say, how can one contribute? I know I'm about 5 minutes before, so I think more time for question and answers. How can one contribute to civic technology? I saw in some of the questions that were asked that this was a particular area of concern. For one, I think it might be interesting if you're not ready to dive into it, if you're not ready to perhaps dive into it head first, it might be interesting to volunteer for a civic technology nonprofit or a movement. We at Civis are always looking out for volunteers with product management expertise, marketing expertise, to come in and perhaps help us with a strategic approach on how we can achieve our goals. So that is definitely something that you could consider to do to actually have some level of involvement in civic technology. When I say movements, I make that as a separate distinction, because oftentimes in civic technology, before an organization is set up or a company is set up, it's a movement or a amalgamation of like-minded people that actually start out with setting out some goals that they want to achieve, which then translates into an organization. Like I mentioned, in 2015, I started working with a similar movement based in Argentina. And that was my entry point into the world of civic technology. So the second thing that I would like to say is explore the ecosystem. If you have an idea which you want to grow into a civic technology startup, there are plenty of us who would be able to and would be more than willing to kind of come in and speak to you on a more candid basis and tell you exactly where are the interventions needed, what are the organizations working in this space. And I'm happy to have those conversations at any point if you feel like this is something that you'd like to take on in a more serious way. The third and importantly also, if you have the propensity for this, support civic technology startups or nonprofits as an investor or philanthropist. I think it's a new space that needs a lot more support in terms of capital as well. And any sort of support that you're able to provide or any sort of resources that you're able to direct to this would be something that would be a worthy and interesting cause. So with that, I'm going to cap my presentation. Perhaps we could open it out for questions and see if there is something that you'd like to discuss. So I see Sai has asked a question. I'm just going to jump headlong into that. Sai asks, how does the revenue model for a civic technology startup look like? Are all the startups in this field nonprofit? That's an interesting question, Sai. I would say that it's a 50-50 split between for-profit organizations and nonprofit organizations. But also what tends to happen is that there is the format of a hybrid organization. So in these hybrid organizations, your initial capital is provided through philanthropic grants, and after which you set up a for-profit business model as well that then supports your work and lets you take it to sustainability. So raising capital in this space with just a business plan is something that has been traditionally difficult in the past, but continues to get easier. Essentially, that is something that continues to get easier, but I would recommend that you look at a hybrid business model if it is something that's of interest to you. In addition to that, in the Status of Civic Tech in India report that Omidyar put out, they actually detailed exactly what is the breakup of for-profit, non-profit, hybrid organizations, and that might be interesting to look into as well and see how that has panned out. Sudhir asks, how do we approach to volunteer with Civis? Sudhir, more than happy to get in touch. My colleague Divya is on this call and she will just reach out to you with our contact details. It's fairly straightforward. I mean, info@civis.vote is our email ID. Just write in, reach out to us on LinkedIn or Twitter or whichever platform you feel comfortable in, and we'd be excited to see how we can work with you to utilize your skill sets for Civis. So thank you so much for that generous offer, and we'll reach out to you for that. Navneet asks, what are the challenges with managing government relationships? What are their expectations? Navneet, I think this is an interesting question. I have seen the ecosystem and the government's openness and willingness to actually engage with civic technology companies greatly increase over the past few years. So I think this is a good time to actually get involved. And when it comes to challenges, essentially, I think the tendering process tends to be a hindrance for a few for-profit organizations that are looking to work with the government. Civis is a non-profit, and that's not something that always applies to us. But when it comes to for-profit companies also, of late I've been seeing that the Maharashtra government, the Gujarat government, and a few others, Haryana as well, have really opened up their doors through startup programs, which are not just for your typical zero years to 1 year type startups, but actually extend over to companies that are 10 or 15 years old. The reason that this process has been put in place is really so that you can overcome some of the challenges of the tendering system. And I've seen many organizations use these opportunities very effectively to work with governments at the highest level and work scale up projects with them in a very quick and efficient manner. So I would definitely again recommend that you speak to a few people who have done this before to see how it works with government. And Jyotirmoy asks, are there many Indian funders who support civic tech nonprofits, given that it requires funders with high maturity? Right, I just realized that everyone can read the questions, so perhaps it's not helpful for me to go over them again. But Jyotirmoy, that's a good question. How many funders? Are there funders? Yes, there are funders. Is the funding support rising? Yes, it is. And I believe with COVID response sort of startups that have come up to actually help governments combat crisis at scale using technology, that this pool of support is only going to rise in the coming years, perhaps not immediately, but definitely in the coming years, because the possibility of public-private partnerships at a startup level has now been explored in India. What are the types of funders in India that are supporting civic tech? I could perhaps share a few organizations. Omidyar Network does a lot to support civic tech ventures in India. They have both a for-profit and a non-profit model. The Distribution for Development Prize, which is the D Prize based out of San Francisco, also does a lot. In addition to that, philanthropies like the Rohini Lilakani Philanthropy actually support civic technology very actively. So there are a gamut of funders who are able to extend support in currently in the ecosystem. Yes, Sai, again, you can bring a company CSR budget into funding civic technology, but from my understanding of CSR rules, it will have to be a Section 8 or a trust or society. So it'll have to be a nonprofit model that CSR can support. CSR cannot always support social enterprises, but a nonprofit model is possible for CSR to support. To what extent does the customer feedback impact government decisions to pass a bill? Consider certain tweaks and amendments. Okay, great. I think in some of the work that we have done, where we have actually illustrated or been able to work with the government from the formative stage of a consultation, which is before they even put the draft law or policy out into the public domain, we've seen a 47% adoption of citizens' feedback into a policy. That is fairly large because as the situation stands today, there is perhaps very negligible amount of citizens' feedback that is actually taken into a policy decision. So 47% is perhaps a landmark in its own right. Is there a gray area? That is an interesting question. There is a gray area. It's perhaps not always a yes or a no. The governments are amenable to understanding research, understanding citizens' lived experiences, and actually converting that into something that they can use for policies. And CIVIS works very actively on that front as well to ensure that not just the demand side, as we see it, which is the citizens, are catered to, but also the supply side, which is the government. How do you enable governments to be able to actually translate and understand feedback at that scale? We currently use a few AI and NLP tools to do that, but it is something that we have seen success with, because I think once the government sees that it's a qualitative input from a citizen who they perhaps haven't heard from before, it doesn't matter. They're excited to incorporate that. And a lot of that happens in the form of amendments and certain gray areas or certain sort of flexible tweaks within a policy. The next question is local government level. Are there any that enable participatory budgeting? Great question. Local governments, so as I would see it, a bulk of civic technology organizations in India actually work on urban local bodies. Fewer perhaps work on rural development issues, but there are a number of organizations. So participatory budgeting, I would recommend that you look at Janagraha's I Change My City platform. They do an annual campaign in Bangalore, and I'm not sure where you're based, but in Bangalore, they do an annual campaign called My City, My Budget, where they actually enable participatory budgeting for urban local bodies. On this note, also, Janagraha does some fantastic work on sharing municipal budgets and actually engaging with governments to proactively share their own budgets. And they've done some fantastic work on that that domain in Karnataka. So I saw that that was one of the questions that was asked beforehand. And other organizations that work on urban local bodies, Reap Benefit is a very exciting organization. They do work on actually enabling civic volunteers to solve local problems. So rather than perhaps relying on the municipality or, for example, relying on the municipality to discover a problem, they enable citizens through a mapping software to actually go out, speak to their corporator, say this is a problem, and then help the corporator design solutions for that problem. They primarily work with younger citizens, but I think it's a very commendable effort that they've undertaken. CIVIS itself does a lot of work on urban local bodies and on urban policies, specifically on a type of policy called a city master plan. So once every 20-ish years, there is a complete overhaul of urban planning that is taken place, an overhaul and an assessment. And plans are made for what the next 20 years should bring for a particular city. And those master plans actually have a large component of citizens' feedback, and CIVIS works on the urban level facilitating those conversations as well. What are some of the key entry barriers for civic tech organizations? What are some of the ways that we have been able to overcome them? I think key barriers to entry, one of the big ones is access to capital. We have at CIVIS really bootstrapped for a long time to be able to illustrate a proof of concept. And I think the ecosystem itself has matured in certain respects as well. But the highest perhaps barrier to entry is access to capital. When it comes to government partnerships, I don't quite foresee that as a barrier to entry. I think there are now, with at least with state governments, there are interesting fellowships, there are interesting There are interesting fellowships. So you could perhaps reach out to the fellows of the particular local government. For example, in Maharashtra, you have the Chief Minister's Fellows. They are usually fairly approachable, also keen to work on new projects and to help you navigate the system. I wouldn't see government as a roadblock at all. I think they've taken on the role of a facilitator. How did CIVIS overcome these challenges? I think one of the big things for us and one of the important factors in the work that we do is being a nonprofit. That has helped us a lot, specifically in this space. But again, there are organizations, and I forget the name right now, but there is a particular organization within that Omidyar report. I think it goes by the name of Recycle, which has benefited from perhaps, which has converted now, I shouldn't say benefited, but which has converted now from a non-profit to a for-profit model. So they have, while they used to do waste management in cities and actually gather waste from local homes, they've now seen that their model is far more effective if they adopt a for-profit business approach. So in our case specifically, again, because we work on a slightly smaller niche where the literature is less, right? There are fewer success stories in citizens' engagement than there are even in other realms of civic tech. Being a nonprofit helped us, but that's not to say that that's the only way to go about it. I think Civil Cops is an interesting organization that has done a lot of work in this space with the for-profit business model, has scalable partnerships with state governments, and is doing some incredible work there. So I think that's a model, again, that that one could look at. On what basis are civic technology startups helping government and citizens? Do governments ask to help from startups? Yes. So I think it is both an inbound and an outbound process. There is a certain amount of credibility that you get once you have worked on a government project or a partnership. Going from there, also, I think there are instances in which the governments would reach out to nonprofits or startups to actually help them with solutions. But again, another way of doing this and getting discovered very quickly is the startup innovation challenges. They typically have a segment for governance, and they want to understand what are the different solutions provided. And this could be very wide ranging. Like, civic technology has a very broad gamut. So for example, it could be even online dispute resolution tools, or it could be specific tools on doing B2B, providing B2B services for governments, right? So not going into the citizen user phase, but providing services within the government. So I think that that is also an opportunity. And there are a lot of government organizations that are open to partnership. The next question is, does a startup have to revise their strategy and plan with changing governments or bureaucrats? I would say no. I don't think that is something that one needs to worry about. I would say if the focus on the work is there and you have a demonstrable experience of working in a particular area and on an issue, it doesn't matter so much whether the governments change or the officers get transferred. There is some amount of consistency that you're able to prove by virtue of having engaged in the past and having sort of clear deliverables that you have provided to the government. Can civic technology reduce excessively complicated administrative procedure? Very much. That is definitely something that civic technology organizations they look to do. So I would say, for example, there is a set of metrics now that that each government has to, or each municipality has to provide citizens easy access to services on. So, for example, provision of birth and death certificate, a category on which the government is supposed to have an online portal. The other one is complaint registration. I'm based out of Mumbai, and I know the MCGM has a very active complaint registration portal. The other thing, interesting use cases also come out in municipalities like the Navi Mumbai Municipal Corporation, where they have even urban transport and buses and bus services that the city provides mapped to an app, which is very responsive and can actually help citizens access urban transport amenities easily. The goal is to reduce complicated administrative procedure. That being said, even within that, there are certain limitations, I feel. But I think also what is important to kind of remember is that oftentimes when these apps are designed or when these citizen service delivery kits are designed, they are done for the common base denominator. So they're perhaps looking at the largest number of people who have the same problem and how they can design for that. So of course there will be individual use cases where an intervention may not help. But that being said, I think there has been very commendable work that has been done in this space in the recent past.
So thanks a lot, Andhra, for taking out time and conducting such an insightful session for Pragmatic Leaders. I'm sure everyone would have got a lot of new insights about this ecosystem that a lot of people are not aware of.
So please feel free to reach out to me. I've just put down my the Civis email ID in the chat. I'm also putting down my own email ID and my colleague Divya, who is the product manager at Civis, her email ID. Right here, it's just our first names at civis.vote. In addition, LinkedIn, please reach out to me. I will respond to a few requests that I have received and will continue to be active on LinkedIn or Twitter. Feel free to reach out to me.